awesome, mighty God. And when I do think about you sitting on your throne and all of the angels worshipping you, thousands upon thousands, 10,000 times 10,000, what an incredible, awesome picture of the one and only God that we have as our Lord and Saviour and friend. And God, we just come, we kneel before you, and we pray that you will make us new people, that you will change us, you'll challenge us to be more and more like you. And God, I just thank you for our church. I just pray for those who may not be with us today due to ill health, and I uplift them to you this morning, God. I pray for healing to them. I pray for those amongst us who may be not feeling well as well, that you'll put your healing hand upon them as well, God, and guide them in your ways. And I pray that you'll help us to love and support each other as we are on this journey. And the journey, we are to wait patiently. We are to seek out those who don't know you, to spread the good news. And God, we just we can't wait. Just watching that little clip of our early pioneers just brought a bit of excitement, thinking about you coming again soon. And Jesus, I just pray that every single day, no matter what happens, you'll bring us to that place where we realize that you are God, you are real, and that you are coming back. You promised. You said you'd go to the Father's. You'd go to heaven and prepare a place for us. So thank you for that promise. And God, I just pray that you will equip us and help us to truly love and experience your love each day. So thank you for being with us. Thank you for Dr. Ken Landers for coming and sharing the word with us today. May we be encouraged, challenged, and see the picture of you that you want us to see this morning. So thank you, God. We love you. In your name, Jesus. Amen.
I've spoken to him many times and told him I'm not Dr. Ken. Because God is not interested in what titles you have. He's not looking at how much money you have, how many properties you have. He's looking at your heart. Because that's what he wants. He wants us to serve him with love. But this morning, pardon me, I just want to thank the people who did the songs. And wherever I go and I don't choose the words or I choose the songs, the Holy Spirit guides people. Because what they sang about, I feel, is so appropriate for the message, wobble board or rock. And what we're going to talk about this morning, wobble board or rock. Before we start, let's just invite the Holy Spirit. Father, we want to pause for a moment. We want to invite the Holy Spirit. Holy Spirit, we ask you to come down and to open our hearts and our minds as we study your word together, as we consider this important topic, this foundational topic, Father, as we consider it. May we be challenged to commit ourselves to you is my prayer in Jesus' name. Amen. 1 Peter chapter 1. 1 Peter chapter 1. We're just going to look at three verses this morning. 1 Peter chapter 1, and we're reading verse 3, verse 4, and verse 5. 1 Peter chapter 1, verse 3, 4, and 5. And Peter says, blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who according to his great mercy has caused us to be born again to a living hope through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead, to obtain an inheritance which is imperishable and undefiled and will not fade away, reserved in heaven for you who are protected by the power of God through faith for a salvation ready to be revealed in the last time. Now, I'm sure you've been told before that no one knows the truth. Somebody ever in a discussion or an argument tell you, no one knows the truth? But that very statement is self-contradictory. Because if no one knows the truth, then the statement, no one knows the truth, cannot be true. Because the person who made it doesn't know the truth. But friends, we live in a world that is very different from the world that I grew up in. I went on to Google, don't we all? And I looked up how many belief systems there are in the world. Anybody want to hazard a guess? 20,000? No, not quite. Belief systems. We're not talking about denominations. I'm coming to that part. How many belief systems? You know what a belief system is? I spoke to somebody on Thursday about a person that I know, and she was from the Department of DOCS. She was from DOCS, and she was asking me a question about this person that I know. And I said to her, look, I've got a Christian worldview. So I've got a worldview or a belief system. It's called Christian. But how many belief systems? Anybody want to hazard a guess? Six? 100? 4,000. Who said 4,000? Well, you're very close. I cannot verify the truth of this statement because it comes from Wikipedia, not my favorite source of information. But Wiki says there are 4,300 belief systems. 4,300 belief systems. You don't need to check. I just checked it before I came. He's checking me to see if I'm telling the truth. How many denominations are there? Christian denominations. Now, you must remember that a denomination may just be a church which worships, in inverted commas, differently from another church which is 5 kilometers down the road. But how many Christian denominations are there? 3,000. You were closer when you said 20. You were closer when you said 20. You're going down the wrong way. More than 40,000 Christian denominations. Depending on how you define a denomination. But friends, people... I'm sorry to say this. I'm not talking about anybody in the audience, anybody at church. People are very gullible. Thank you. We live in a world where people are confused, where people are fickle and lost. But I want to put it to you this morning. I want you to put on your thinking caps. I want you to put aside all the sugar and the other stuff that's taking your blood sugar too high so that your mind is starting to, and your, I don't want to talk in medical terms, but you start to feel a little drowsy because when you eat, the blood supply goes to your stomach and away from your brain. I want to put it to you that we have a sure foundation. You see, as a Christian, it's not good enough to be told you must just believe. And I was in a church, I won't give you the name of the church, where the pastor said, we must just believe. And I don't accept it. I didn't challenge him from the audience, but I don't accept that. As Christians, we have a reason for why we're not on a wobble board, but we're on a rock. And that reason is in the verses that we looked at this morning. You see, when you survey the religious belief systems of the world, there's only one. There's only one. I'm going to say it again. There's only one religious leader who came and who died and who rose again. There's only one belief system where you believe in somebody who came to live on this earth, who died on this earth, but who rose again, and hallelujah, is coming back. You see, the resurrection is the reason why we believe what we believe. Because if there was no resurrection, there wouldn't have been a crucifixion. If there was no crucifixion, there wouldn't have been any blood spilt. If there was no blood spilt, we would not have been cleansed by the blood of Jesus. Our sins would not have been covered by the blood of Jesus. So the resurrection is the reason why we have a firm foundation. So when we walk down the street, I'm not talking here about physical looks, okay? I know I'm ugly, I'm not talking about physical looks. But I tell this to young people I meet at work all the time. So many young people are walking like this. Maybe it's because they're looking at their phone. If you keep walking like this, you're going to end up like this. And if you end up like this, you're looking at the ground. We need to stand up as Christians. We need to be unafraid, unashamed. We need to stand up and pull our shoulders back and just look. Don't I look younger? But the point is that when we have the right foundation, when our belief systems are not just something nebulous, something airy-fairy, something that is lost up in the cloud. I'm not a Luddite, but I don't like the cloud because when I changed my phone, half of my contacts went and I said, I'm not going to use the cloud again. But we don't have our belief systems up in the cloud. We are resting on the firm foundation. You see, the resurrection has been shown to be the truth. Some of you may know that I love apologetics, and I'm sure when I quote that you'll be aware of this person. Anthony Flew. You ever heard of Anthony Flew? Before Richard Dawkins, he was the world's most famous atheist. And this is what he said. Now, Anthony Flew did not believe in miracles, okay? He belonged to the Hume thought or a Hume school of philosophy. There's no such thing as a miracle. But this is what he said. The evidence for the resurrection is better than for claimed miracles in any other religion. It's outstandingly different in quality and quantity. Okay. And then a quote from some more lawyers, a book called Leading Lawyers Look at the Resurrection. Sir Lionel Luckhoo was listed in the Guinness Book of Records as the most successful lawyer in the world. He defended 245 murderers in a row, and he got them all acquitted. Must have a few brain cells, I think. He was knighted twice. But Sir Lionel Luckhoo said this, I say unequivocally, the evidence for the resurrection of Jesus Christ is so overwhelming that it compels acceptance by proof which leaves absolutely no doubt. Simon Greenleaf was not a Christian. He ended up being the royal professor of law at Harvard University and wrote a 3-volume text called A Treatise on the Law of Evidence. This book was written in the 1800s, but it's still used today by lawyers. And, pardon me, this is what he has to say. Upon the Greenleaf concluded, because he actually set out to disprove the resurrection. And at the end he said, the resurrection of Christ was one of the best supported events in history. Gary Habermas and Michael Licona have written a book in 2004 called The Facts for the Crucifixion. And they list 5 reasons why, as Christians, we can be sure that of the resurrection. Number 1, Jesus died by crucifixion. We don't have time this morning to go into what happened when you were crucified. But unlike our friends from Islam who say that Jesus swooned, people, when they die, when they're crucified, they don't swoon. You don't just lose consciousness. It was well known to be the most cruel way of killing somebody that the world has ever invented. He died by crucifixion, number one. Number two, Jesus' disciples believed that he rose and appeared to them. When you look in Scripture, you see the difference between what happened before Jesus was crucified and after. I mean, on the night when they came to arrest Jesus, what does the Bible tell us? They all forsook him and ran away. I mean, Mark was the first streaker in history. He ran away stark naked, but he wasn't going to wait for his clothing because he wanted to be gone. But just a few, pardon me, days later, the disciples were flogged and they went home rejoicing that they were worthy to suffer for Jesus. What brought about that change in their mindset, in their habit, in the way they comported themselves? The fact that Jesus died, but that he appeared to them again, that he was alive. That's number two. Number three, the church persecutor Paul was suddenly changed. So Paul went from somebody who was breathing murderous threats against Christian to be a believing Christian. Number four, James, the same James who was half-brother of Jesus, who said, "What are you doing skulking around here? Go up to the feast. If you are the one that people are talking about, why aren't you at the feast?" They didn't believe him. His own brothers and, pardon me, and sisters and his own family didn't believe that he was the Messiah. And number five, the tomb was empty. You don't have time, and I don't have time, to look at all the people attacking this one central fact of history. But they cannot explain away those 5 points. And Habermas went to more than 2,200 sources from 1975 to the present. And, pardon me, he said that these events are regarded as historical by almost everybody, including those who are atheists. And I just quote here from an atheist, a person called Gerd Ludemann, who says, "It may be taken as historically certain that Peter and the disciples had experiences after Jesus' death in which Jesus appeared to them as the risen Christ." And he's not a Christian, he's an atheist, but he's a New Testament scholar. So when we consider all the evidence, or if we have time to study all the evidence, this is an historical fact. It is not fiction. It's not something that's out there. And we can rest assured that Jesus came, that he died, and that he rose again. So let's get back to Peter. We are here to study the Bible, aren't we? Not what the lawyers have to say. I want you to notice, and I recognize some faces in the audience, so I must be careful that I don't paraphrase too much that I've already said before at Fountain in the City, but it's my first time I come here today. Thank you to Barend and Pastor Shelton. I want you to notice that when you read the scriptures, you must read word by word. And I want to put it to you, although we didn't read this word, that if we look at 1 Peter chapter 1, verse 1, that there's a very significant word there, and that's the word aliens. Notice what Peter says, 1 Peter 1, verse 1, "To those who reside as aliens." Now, I'm not a movie fan and I've not seen E.T. I don't know if you've ever seen E.T., but E.T. was an alien. Peter's not suggesting that as Christians we must walk around all funny and dress funny and look so completely different from the world. But he's saying to those who desire as aliens, what is an alien? An alien is a person who's not part of the society in which he or she is living. When I came to Australia in the year 1995, the 28th of December, I haven't forgotten it. I was an alien at first. Well, I'm still a bit of an alien because I say 35, and people say 55. No, 35. Oh, yes, 35. So I'm still a bit of an alien. But the point I want to make is that if we were aliens, we wouldn't be seeking for ways in which we can look more like our neighbors. We could practice more like our neighbors. We could fit into society so that it's seamless, so that when people see us, they see no difference between us and the rest of the world. If we were aliens, it would affect our thinking processes. It would affect the way we look at the future, the way we look at our careers, the way we look at ourselves. As people, it would affect us very profoundly in many ways if we were aliens. And Peter is talking here to those who reside as aliens. Friends, if we are Christians and we focused on the fact that Jesus is coming back again, then our thinking pattern should be alien. We should think differently from the world. It's not how much money I can get. It's not how many things I can amass. But it's what when I go out on the street and the Lord, the Holy Spirit impresses on me that I must be a consistent Christian. I'm not only a Christian when it comes to Sabbath, when I'm here at Fountain in the City, Maroubra. I'm a Christian 24/7, 365 days of the year. Whether you wake me up, whether you block me on the street because you are a silly old lady blocking the fast lane. Move out! I'm in a hurry. I must get to church on time. I must be a Christian. When people show you the rude finger because they're in the fast lane and you go past, they show you the rude finger. Have a good day, buddy. This is the point. When we are aliens, it changes our DNA inside so that we live and we act and we talk differently. The things that we're interested in should be eternal things, not ephemeral things. Think about it. To those who reside as aliens, very significant word. Let's move on to our three verses. Peter says, "Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who according to his great mercy," I don't hear it, hallelujah, thank you Jesus, if it wasn't for God's mercy, we would be gone,
I'm sure that most of you are too busy, you know, you've got friends and you've got things to do. But I was on the internet last year, the year before, and I saw this article about this mansion in America. You know, the Americans no Americans here today. They like big houses, don't they? Have you seen some of those houses? $400 million for a house. $400 million. But this guy went on a holiday, and his son invited the friends. Oh boy, they had a party, they had one big party. The house was trashed. They went through it room by room, I don't know how many rooms there were, and they damaged every room. They smashed the walls, the lights, the bathrooms, it was trashed.
I don't know how much mercy he had when he came back. But just think about it for a while. God gave Adam and Eve a perfect world, and what did they do? They started the process of trashing the world. And we're still trashing it today, aren't we? Pollution, you name it, all the things that we do that are damaging God's creation. But you see, friends, this is the whole difference. God has great mercy. Had he not been God, we would have been gone. But because he's God, he's reached out to us. Because he's God, his grace has operated in our sphere. He, through his grace, pardon me, has caused us to be born again, as Peter says. And we were dead. We were really going nowhere. We were really heading for obliteration. But we've been born again. We've been given something new. We've been given something, a belief system. We've been given a paradigm. We've been given a frame of reference by which we can be, pardon me, we can be energized, by which we can be revitalized, by which we can be assured that we believe in a living Father who loves us, a loving Father and a living Father who loves us, and who's coming back again for us. So we're born again with a completely new way of looking at the world. We're born again with new appetites. We're born again with new desires, with new ambitions. We're born again with a new direction. We're looking for something that's eternal, not ephemeral. And Peter says, we were born to a living hope. This is a hope that's organic. The world is hoping for they don't know what. Because depending on your worldview, nothing really is going to happen. If you don't start off right, then you're not going to be right. If you start off with a worldview that has got nothing in its future, well, then what's the point of life? It's all meaningless. Life is meaningless, like Jean-Paul Sartre, the existentialist philosopher, said. Life is meaningless. It's got no meaning. But we as Christians, we've got a living hope. It's organic. It's alive. It's growing. It's different from everyone else around us. They are hopeless. They are not filled with hope. They're filled with despair. You go looking on Google if you want to. The 10 top prescribed medications in the world, and about 4 or 5 of them, if my memory serves me correctly, are mind-altering drugs. Anxiety, depression. The most prescribed medications are drugs that fiddle with your mind. So, God has caused us, because of his mercy, to be born again to a living hope through the resurrection of Jesus. Now, let's go on. You know, maybe I picked too much. Maybe I should scale back and come back if I'm asked to come and preach the rest of the sermon. Because if you look at verse 4, what does Peter say? To obtain an inheritance which is imperishable and undefiled and will not fade away. I don't know if you've noticed, maybe you haven't read Peter, 1 Peter much, but Peter puts things in threes. Why do they use threes? Every number in Scripture is significant. What's the significance of the number 3 in Scripture? The Godhead is 3. The number 3 is divine perfection. 7 is perfection, but the number 3 is divine perfection. Because there's the Godhead. The Holy of Holies was a cube. So the Holy of Holies also had 3 dimensions that were exactly the same. Pardon me. And in fact, if you look at verse 2 of 1 Peter chapter 1, Peter's presenting the Trinity in that second verse. God the Father, by the sanctifying work of the Spirit to obey Jesus Christ. I didn't talk about it. Pardon me, but the inheritance that we have, and this is another thing that gives us hope, doesn't it? We do have an inheritance. We do have something that's been put aside. We've got something that's imperishable. We've got something that's undefiled. And we've got something that is unfading. It's defying the laws of nature. Those of you that have done physics, you know the second law of thermodynamics says what? That something starts at a point, does it get better? It gets worse. That everything will decay over time. But here Peter is saying that this inheritance that we have is something so different that it's not following the laws of nature. It's undecaying. It's unfading. And it's undefiled and it's imperishable. And shouldn't we be excited? I mean, you know, I work, as you may or may not know, I work in jail. And a Thursday I went to work, and there were three guys standing by the door. I looked around and I thought, what? I know these guys. They looked a bit familiar. It was three of my patients. I don't call them crims. That's what the officers call them. Three of my patients who were going home. And so they were all dressed up in normal clothes. And they looked so happy because they're going home. And just so should we be. Every day should be a celebration on the fact that we're one day closer to going home. That we're one day closer to escaping the rat race, the traffic of Sydney.
I don't like to talk about websites, but there's going to be, when I get down to it, a website called suddenlysucks.com. But, pardon me, we are one day closer. Every day that comes that we are alive, we are one day closer from escaping the effects of living in this world, escaping the pollution, escaping the crime, escaping the cancer, escaping the pain. We're one day closer to heaven. And that in itself should be a reason for us to be filled with joy, filled with peace, filled with hope. Every day, I don't need to worry about my super. Because you're not going to get your super. If you live the way Jesus wants us to live, you're not going to reach super. You know, I'm
sure you all know, if I've been a doctor for more than 30 years, I must be pretty old. But I'm not expecting to use my super. Because I believe, I'm not a prophet, and don't go and tell Pastor Barend I said this. I'm not setting any dates, but I believe the world is coming to an end very soon. Very soon, sooner than we think. The Bible says that the last movements will be what? Rapid ones. The last movements will be rapid ones. So I don't believe that I'm going to get my super. So why should I bother to pay off my house so that the bank can have all the money? My wife wants me to pay it off. I don't want to pay it off. I want to use that money, friends. If we're living for end times, I'm sure that God would prefer us to use that money to help to spread the gospel than to pay off your house so that you can be all happy in your house. I don't need a house to be happy. All I need is to know that when I wake up in the morning, Jesus has woken me up and that he's going to be with me wherever I go. I don't need to be scared about the fact that I do almost 1,000 kilometers a week, that I'm traveling at 110 kilometers an hour in the rain, and I may die. If I die, I die. Doesn't matter. It doesn't matter. And so Peter says that you're going to get an inheritance which is imperishable and undefiled and will not fade away. Notice the next word, reserved. It's all guaranteed. I mean, we're looking at a truth which is foundational to our worldview, that Jesus came, that he died, but that he was resurrected. You see, we don't follow Muhammad. I mean, Muhammad is dead. We don't follow Gautama Buddha. Buddha's dead. None of them are alive. Only Jesus is alive.
Amen.
And Peter says that it's reserved. Nobody's going to come at the last minute and grab your inheritance. If you stay faithful, your name is printed on it and it's yours. But notice verse 5. reserved in heaven for you who are protected by the power of God. Hallelujah. God is protecting you. He's looking after you from the day that you were born until the day that you die. God is looking after you all the way. He's protecting you. So many times, just think about it. So many times you've had close escapes, haven't you? I know I had one, pardon me, 160 on a motorbike. 160 on a motorbike, going in and out of the traffic like that. I was young, you know, I was young. I was testosterone charged, I was stupid, I was young, I was stupid. When I got to the end, I said, I could have been dead.
I'm not suggesting that any of you go and do that. You can't do that here in, this was in South Africa. You can't do that here in Australia. You'd be locked away. It was a 60 zone. I was only doing 160 on a motorbike. And Beryl was hanging on for dear life behind me. But God protects us. I mean, we've got a cast iron case. Yeah, in these three verses, for believing in a God who looks after you, who's died for you, and who's got an inheritance all sorted out, and who's looking after you physically as well, so that when, pardon me, when you pass, you know you're dying with hope, you're not dying in despair. And he says, we're protected by the power of God through faith for a salvation ready to be revealed in the last time. God's power is working for each one of us if we accept it by faith. If we accept that we don't know the future, if we accept that we don't know the best way to live, if we accept that we don't know how we should behave ourselves, but when God comes into our lives and changes us from the inside out, then we can live the way He wants us to live. And then we're filled with joy, we're filled with hope, we filled with peace. We are filled with a certain knowledge that Jesus is coming back, and He's coming back for us. And shouldn't we be filled with excitement as well that this is happening sooner than we think? Sooner than we think. You know, I often wonder you come, you preach, you go home, it doesn't really matter, does it? The message, what matters is whether or not each one of you that is sitting here today has got that connection with Jesus. Each one of us need that connection. And I want to ask you this morning, don't signify anything, because we've been talking up in the mind where everything sits, where every conscious decision, every thought, every action, it's all up in your mind. Nobody knows where it is. But I'm talking to your mind. Are you sure that if you were to pass tonight, that you would wake up and see Jesus? Have you made that commitment to Jesus? Have you made that connection by going down on your knees and acknowledging that you are sinful and that you are in need of a Savior? Because that's all that matters. If we don't have that connection, when Jesus comes, are we going to be on the rock, or are we going to be trying to get under the rock? Are we going to be crying out to the rocks and the mountains, fall on us?
Or will we be standing there with our bodies supercharged with that supernatural excitement, knowing that this is now the end of the world? This is serious stuff, guys. It's not airy-fairy, nimby-pimby stuff. It's serious stuff. It's life and death stuff. So each one of you must look inside yourselves and answer that question for yourself. Not for me. I'm not here to save you. I can't save you. I can only reveal what's in the scripture, but I can't save you. Only Jesus can save you. Let's close our eyes. Father, we recognize that we are lost without Jesus in our lives. We want to acknowledge that only Jesus can give us meaning, only Jesus can give us hope, and only Jesus is coming back again. Father, you know everybody who's seated here this morning. You know what's going on inside their lives at this very time. You know, in fact, you know every thought in their minds at this very time. And Father, you know whether or not they've made that decision to commit themselves to you. Oh, Father, please, if there is somebody here this morning who's not made that commitment yet, Holy Spirit, please prompt them. Holy Spirit, please put a needle, put a sword through their consciences, put a something into them that will remind them that you've been speaking to them for weeks, you've been pleading with them, you've been haranguing them, you've been coaxing them, you've been asking them to make that commitment. But they either too busy or they too engrossed in the things of the world. They're too tied up with worldly, with ephemeral things, and they're not focusing on the eternal. Holy Spirit, please. We know that Jesus' coming is soon. But above all, we know that any one of us may pass today, and then we'll be past the point of no return. And if we've not made that decision yet, it will be too late. So please, Holy Spirit, please continue to plead with them to make that commitment until they do make that commitment and invite Jesus into their lives. And find the peace that passes all understanding. Find the joy that only followers of Jesus can have. Find the hope that's living, that's organic, that's growing. And finally, obtain that inheritance which is imperishable and undefiled and unfading. Thank you, Father. Thank you for your word, is my prayer in Jesus' name. Amen.
Is one.
What a beautiful song. Let's just close our eyes. Father, we just want to thank you for your love. Unworthy as we may be, we are nothing. We have nothing. But we owe everything to you. So fill us with that love, please, Father. So that others around us can see your love in our lives, in our actions, in our words, the way we talk. Fill us with your love. And Father, may your love become the mainspring of our lives. May everything that we do be motivated by the love that you put in us for you and for others. And may that love so change us that when you come back again because of your great love in dying for us, when you come back again to take us to be with you, that each one who's in this sanctuary this morning will be ready to go with you to eternity. Take us safely now when we do travel home, Father, and be with us through the days and weeks that lie ahead. May we look for opportunities to reach out to all those around us in whatever way we can, is my prayer. In Jesus' name, amen.